morning.
Good morning.
We're going to learn a new song today. Woohoo! This might remind you of a Buddy Holly song, but it isn't that song. But you'll probably find the tune slightly familiar. It's in your bulletin.
Church. For those who are joining us online, we hope that you can join us soon in the sanctuary. I am Reverend Barbara Hess. I am joined today by Karen Ducharme, who is our music director, Jay Ducharme, who is our technical guru and soloist, and Judy Ford Giacastro, who is our fabulous liturgist. Fabulous, fabulous. And Devin Dakota rang the bell today. Welcome.
Divine.
Oh, wait a minute. I changed things and I didn't even. I didn't even pay attention. I'm sorry. No, for those of you who have missed the right-handed fellowship, we're not going to have it. But we're going to have something somewhat similar. We're going to stand up. And we're going to look at others, and we are going to smile and wait. I'm sorry, what?
How do you know we're smiling?
That's true. With the masks on, you cannot be smiling. And as long as you wave and nod your head, we'll think that you are. So behold the children of God surrounding you. Come on, get up. Behold the children of God surrounding you. Through a wave and a smile, acknowledge the spark of the divine within one another. See the presence of Christ in the faces of your neighbors, affirming that we are all treasured children of God. Oh, come on, you guys can do it better than that. Look at individuals, look at them, and smile and wave. damn it.
Divine deliverer of compassion, you call us to follow your voice. Whom shall I send? You ask us.
With hearts of hope and souls filled with courage, we respond, here I am, send me.
You evaporate our shame and joyously embrace our authentic selves.
We reclaim the moment of ourselves to you, and may we embrace our full humanity as in you. Amen.
And sticking with the Here I Am theme, our next hymn is Here I Am, Lord, which is in your bulletin. You might remember this.
I'm not afraid to
with the students. This hymn was often sung when the students took the Eucharist. It always has special meaning. Let us confess our sins and then share a moment of silence. Too often we have come to the thought that we are too sinful for you. I too often we have used our shameful path with the closed future. From these beliefs we condemn ourselves to an outlook without hope. Go away from me, we exclaim like Peter. I am way too lost, we think like Isaiah. But you have something different in mind. You see us as so much more. You see our divine image and our Creator's solar gifts. Save us from our negative self-talk, that we may embrace your calling for our lives. We ask this in Jesus' name, who taught us to praise and sing. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the power and the glory forever. Amen.
The grace of God has molded us throughout our lives and will continue to do so until our final breath. God's grace is never in vain. Even as God embraces our past, God moves us into the future, a future filled with hope and the fulfillment of dreams.
The Old Testament reading is from Isaiah 6:1-13. Last week, the prophet Jeremiah was telling God all the reasons that Jeremiah felt as to why he couldn't serve God. This week, we have the prophet Isaiah calling out, "Here I am, send me." God calls all of us to serve. What's keeping you from calling out to God? Here I am, send me. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord sitting up on the throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Above him stood the seraphim. Each had six wings. With two he covered his face, and with two he covered his feet, and with two he flew. And one called to another and said, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory." And the foundations of the thresholds shook at the voice of him who called. And the house was filled with smoke. And I said, "Woe is me, for I am lost, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of a people of unclean lips, for my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." Then flew one of the seraphim to me, having in his hand a burning coal, which he had taken with tongs from the altar. And he touched my mouth and said, "Behold, this has touched your lips, your guilt is taken away, and your sin is forgiven." And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, "Whom shall I send, and who will go for us?" Then I said, "Here am I, send me." And he said, "Go and say to this people, hear and hear, but do not understand. See and see, but do not perceive. Make the heart of this people fat and their ears heavy, and shut their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and turn and be healed." Then I said, "How long, O Lord?" And he said, "Until cities lie waste without inhabitant, and houses without men, and the land is utterly desolate, and the Lord removes men far away, and the forsaken places are many in the midst of the land. And though a tenth remain in it, it will be burned again, like a terebinth or an oak, whose stump remains standing when it is built. The holy seed is its stump."
Thank you, Judy.
The gospel reading today is from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 5, verses 1 through 11. Miracles happen all around us if we will open our eyes to see them. Here Jesus is asking Simon Peter to trust Jesus and try a new way of doing things. First, Simon Peter needed to trust Jesus. Then Simon Peter needed to do as Jesus asked. Finally, Simon Peter needed to decide what to do with this newfound abundance. If you were Simon Peter, would you have given up everything to follow Jesus? Hear now the word of the gospel. Once while Jesus was standing beside the lake of Gennesaret, and the crowd was pressing in on him to hear the word of God, he saw two boats there at the shore of the lake. The fishermen had gone out of them and were washing their nets. He got into one of the boats, the one belonging to Simon, and asked him to pull out a little way from the shore. Then he sat down and taught the crowds from the boat. When he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Simon answered, "Master, we have worked all night, but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." When they had done this, they caught so many fish that their nets were beginning to break. So they signaled their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled both boats, so they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell on his knees, saying, "Go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man." For he and all who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. Then Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catchers of people." When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Our God is still speaking, and we need to keep listening. Please be with me in a spirit of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable and pleasing to you, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. For the last few weeks, I've been preaching from 1 Corinthians instead of the gospel. Remember that the gospels are Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. These are only four books of the New Testament. The gospel reading I didn't include when we were covering 1 Corinthians had Jesus preaching at the temple. And in the very beginning, people were amazed, but that didn't last long. Pretty soon, everyone in Nazareth was annoyed with Jesus. This is a little like the beginning of some TV shows you might have seen previously on The Young and the Restless. Okay, everybody was annoyed with Jesus as we pick up the story, because while preaching, Jesus had the audacity to say that everyone was entitled to God's love and grace. That doesn't sound controversial to us today, but back then, people were really, really ticked off by Jesus' teaching. The Israelites were annoyed because Jesus was saying that God's love and grace was also for everyone, including the Gentiles. And Gentiles were anyone who wasn't. The Gentiles and pagans were those who were not Jewish. Up until then, the Israelites had viewed themselves as God's chosen people. They were annoyed with Jesus, but they weren't the only ones who were annoyed with Jesus. The wealthy were annoyed with Jesus because Jesus was saying that God had the audacity to love the poor. The politically well-connected were annoyed because Jesus was preaching that God loved those who were marginalized by society. God loved the disenfranchised. Everyone was annoyed. Jesus was persona non grata. When the gospel reading ended last week, the crowd was literally chasing Jesus and trying to run him off a cliff. He somehow escaped and made his way back through the crowd. So this week we're picking up where we would have been if we had read the Gospel of Luke all along. This week the crowds are pushing in and trying to get to Jesus, but this crowd is a different crowd. It's in a different location. The geographical context of this gospel reading is Capernaum, a city in Galilee. It's totally different geography than the one from last week. This crowd is pressing in on Jesus to hear the word of God. Now, Jesus hops into one of the boats, the boat owned by Simon Peter, but this isn't as weird as it sounds, because in the gospel reading we skipped, Jesus actually knew Simon Peter. He had eaten at Simon Peter's house, and he had cured Simon Peter's mother-in-law when she was sick. They weren't the best of buddies, but they certainly weren't strangers. So when Jesus hopped into Peter's boat and instructed him to put out a little bit from shore, Simon Peter dutifully obeyed. When Jesus finished teaching with the crowds, Jesus said to Simon, "Put out into deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Here is where it gets a little bit interesting, because I wonder how many of us would have listened to Jesus. And I'm including myself in this rhetorical question. How many of us would have listened to Jesus and followed his instructions? Because when Jesus first hopped into Peter's boat, Peter, James, and John, they were all fishermen by trade, and they were all partners. Peter, James, and John were cleaning out their nets. And that's what fishermen do at the end of the day. So they had worked all night, and they were cleaning their nets, which is a tedious job at best. They cleaned their nets to keep the nets in good working order. So during the first century, commercial fishermen fished at night when the fish would come up to the surface because the water at the surface was warmer. So Peter, James, and John had fished all night long and had come into the shore, and they were washing their nets. And Jesus hops into the boat. So not only were Simon Peter, James, and John at the end of their working day, they had just finished cleaning up when Jesus said, "Put out into deep water and let down your nets for a catch." Remember that this Jesus fellow who was telling them to put their boats out into deep water and let down their nets was a carpenter. He wasn't a fisherman. So, carpenter is in the process of telling the professional fisherman how to fish. And, we have to think about how it would be today. How many of us would be eager to follow Jesus at the end of our workday and in a situation where we think we know more than Jesus? We have more expertise than Jesus. But Peter was obedient. And he also shows that Peter was human. In essence, Peter is saying, "Really, Jesus? Really?" What it says in the gospel is, "Master, we have worked all night, but have caught nothing. Yet if you say so, I will let down the nets." This is being begrudgingly obedient. This is how we might respond when we are called to do something. "Yeah, Jesus, I'll do as you ask, but I'm telling you that it's not gonna work. I'm just saying." I've been known to do that once or twice myself. Look what happens next. They catch so many fish that their nets begin to rip. This is abundance. But it's also where it's easy to question Jesus. Do we really want abundance? We talk about it. We all talk about wanting abundance, but do we really want it? We question, "Yes, Jesus, of course we want more people to attend our church." But when those new people come in, they sometimes have new ideas. And they don't know that we've always done it that way, or that way, or whatever way. They have different experiences, and they might have different ways of looking at things. What's up with that? We have to be careful what we wish for. And when we get it, we need to be thanking God that we have. Back to Simon, Peter, James, and John in their fishing boat. I'm sorry to keep switching back and forth between the gospel and the present day, but I want you to understand that this is applicable for us today. It's not just another story in the Bible. This is what we're dealing with today when Jesus wants us to be the church. In the gospel reading, there are so many fish in the bulging nets. Simon Peter calls to other boats to help. Now, when the additional boat comes out to help, there are two more questions. First, are Peter, James, and John willing to share the abundance? Even sharing the abundance threatens to capsize both boats. Is this where some of us are saying to Jesus, hey, this abundance thing is getting dangerous. Maybe we need to go back to a time before the abundance and just play it safe. Sometimes it is so tempting to hold back and play it safe. Hold back and play it safe, even though Jesus is in charge. Open hands can catch blessings and accept blessings. Clenched fists cannot accept blessings. How often do we clench our fists in trying to hold on to what we have instead of trusting God? If God provided and has provided what we have, God will provide even more when we stop trying to selfishly keep all that we've been given. Again, I say open hands can accept blessings, and clenched fists cannot accept blessings. Simon Peter said, go away from me, Lord, for I am a sinful man. For he and all the who were with him were amazed at the catch of fish they had taken. Here's another mistake we make. If Jesus calls us to partner with him, who are we to say we do not want to partner with Jesus? What happens when Peter, James, and John brought their boats to shore? The gospel reading tells us, then Jesus said to Simon, do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching people. When they had brought their boats to shore, they left everything and followed him. This statement alone could be a whole other sermon. What does it mean to leave everything and follow Jesus? I won't go into that today, but in closing, I want to leave you with a two-part question. First, do you really trust that God will provide? And second, when you choose to follow Jesus, are you keeping clenched fists on the abundance you already have been given, just in case this Jesus thing doesn't work out? Or do you trust that God will continue to provide? Amen.
Next hymn is in the Black New Century hymnal, You Have Come Down to the Lakeshore.
I did not know that hymn prior to coming to serve at Second Congregational Church. The first time I knew of it was when Joe Giacastro passed, and Judy wanted that. And, what? Now it is one of my favorites. It is just so lovely, absolutely lovely. We come now to our time of joys and concerns. We have some that have already been shared. We are having Thanksgiving, prayers of Thanksgiving that Nick has a full-time job. We have prayers of healing for Liz. We have prayers of Thanksgiving that Patrick took Anthony and Devin to a retreat at Monadnock, and all were impacted, and we have prayers of Thanksgiving that Patrick is someone who stands up and volunteers for special assignments. We have prayers of Thanksgiving that Peggy will be going to see her grandchildren, who she hasn't seen in 2 years. Danielle, Wyatt, and Landon will be going to Disney. Prayers for Linda's sister-in-law and her medical professionals. Prayers of Thanksgiving for a wonderful annual meeting. Prayers for those who are having surgery within the next 2 months. Prayers for Diana J's best friend Paula, who is terminally ill. Prayers for Charlie, Francis N., Jonathan, Gina, Emily, David, John, Ruth, and Sue F's family. Please be with me in the spirit of prayer. We come into your presence with praise on our lips and love in our hearts, O God. Please accept our songs of praise as sweet offerings to you for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. Hear our songs and purify our hearts. Help us to hear you call in our lives, and even as we hear, to respond with faith and commitment. Guide us to love you more deeply. Lead us to love one another more. Help us to love others with the kind of love you have already shown us. Help us to help others. We lift names and situations to you, Lord. You know what they need. Be with the following people and situations and guide us as to how we can best help you help them. We praise you and give you our love. Praise the name of the Lord. Amen. The divine deliverer of compassion and care is calling us now to serve, and to serve with our talents and treasures for the good of God's realm. No matter how we have fallen short in the past, God's grace assures us a variety of gifts to contribute. How is God calling us to share today? Please join me in the offering dedication as found in the bulletin. Loving God, deliverer of compassion, you call us to share our treasures and talents and the work of our hands. With hearts filled with hope, we praise you for our bounty. Forever shall we sing your generous ways, Holy One. Amen.
Our communion hymn is on page 347 in the Black New Century Hymnal, Let Us Talents and Tongues.
Thank you. prayer of thanksgiving in the bulletin, as found in the bulletin. We give thanks, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us at your table by granting us the presence of your Son, Jesus Christ. Strengthen our faith, increase our love for one another, and send us forth into the world in courage and peace, rejoicing in the power of the Holy Spirit.
And our closing hymn today is on page 252 in your Black Century Hymnal, Savior, Like a Shepherd Keep Us.
In this season of light, experience instead the steadfast love of God and sing the ways of our merciful Creator. Amen.